We'll get started again. My name, please feel free to interrupt. The previous group was incredibly polite and almost didn't say anything, which made me feel very self-conscious of my own voice after 30 minutes. My role, what I do, which is probably quite opaque, I've done everything, as in with Sonos. I worked in retail for 15 years prior to Sonos, hi-fi shops, and then video conferencing, then Sonos. So I've been on your side of the desk, so to speak. And my heart goes out. I couldn't do it in my old age. My mobile number, my email address. Do feel free. You've got West End, amazing resource. The reason why we put them on is because previously it was one guy, 300-400 dealers. Now you have West End, but you also have me. So any issues, if you can't get through to Mike, you can always call my mobile number. As I said, 12 years at Sonos. So if I don't know, there's just the tech support team and that's it. Do keep this conversational. Don't put your hand up. You have a question, a theory, a comment, just yell out. I want to make you aware of the EPP, the Employee Purchase Program, right? We've run this for several years. It offers full-time employees of all of our reseller network 45% off RRP, right? So you go in, you create a username and a password, register. We pay a third party at the moment to validate your employment status. It takes about a week. It's a phone call. And once we've done that, we send you a link. You can then go in, log in using that username and password and purchase any of our products at 45% off, up to about $3,500. We do this because we know that if you own our product and use it at home, it makes it super easy to sell and it makes you enthusiastic about selling because you'll realize the full benefits of the product. Likewise, if there's any additional information or you're one of these people who learns slightly differently, you just want to access the internet for a training session. That dog is so distracting. I just want to pat it. There's only.sonos.com, which allows you to go in and do little bite-sized chunks of lessons with questions at the end of them so you can validate that you've absorbed the information. So both of those things, if you want to make a note, good resources. I'm starting to lose my voice already. So, the things we're going to go through today, what is Sonos, the very basic what and why of what we do, where we came from, why you sell it, what are its key points of differentiation between us and a lot of the other products on the market, and the product portfolio, relatively new, brand new to our brand, so I'll go through each piece and explain what the differences are, feature sets, and functionality. So, to start with the what. We invented wireless multi-room. So prior to Sonos coming on board, I worked in a handful of different hi-fi shops in Melbourne, and selling a multi-room system, I felt bad. You felt bad enough selling a Xantec Sonance Axiom 4, 8, 16 zone amplifier controller, but then you also had the keypads on the walls, you had the cabling and infrastructure, all of the in-ceiling speakers, and the programming used to kill us because the programming, we didn't have a programmer, you'd have to outsource that, they'd own the program, you know how that goes. It's problematic and it's tens of thousands of dollars potentially. I will never forget the day that my eventual boss came into our store. I worked at Setcha Audio, which has now become Melbourne Hi-Fi many years later, and said, I've got a product. He literally had a little suitcase, a daggy little suitcase. I've got a product that I want to sell you. And I was like, we don't want anything else. We've got a shop full of gear and, you know, please. He said, I'll just set it up and I'll just show it to you. He unboxes two things and a controller. I don't know what those two things are. They look like little computer Apple products, predecessor to our amp and our port. He sets them up, plugs the port into existing hi-fi system that we had, and he put the controller in my hands, and this is the important part of it. And he says, think of an artist you like, someone you want to listen to, find it by searching and press play. I'm like, oh, okay. This guy's confident, he's a bit, seemed a little bit like a smart ass. Like, okay, no worries. So I went and tried to look for a, for me, what I knew was a relatively obscure jazz trio operating out of New York. Guys are in their 20s at the time, and the band was called Alas No Axis. Drummer's name was Jim Black. It doesn't matter. I went A-L-A-S-N-O, and it auto-completed, and there were four albums there. I'm like, oh, okay, wow. Press play, and this music starts playing out of the system. Access to music. We invented that. Prior to that, it was incredibly difficult and expensive to boot. I'll keep yammering on about this second point, a software-driven audio company. Most of our competitors are hardware companies that have retrofitted some software to enable wireless multi-room to be available on their product. What that means is that when they change their hardware, they have software issues. When they change their software, they have hardware issues, because the two things are not built simultaneously and they're not built with each other in mind, so to speak. Sonos started with software. We started with the idea that we wanted to control audio wirelessly through endpoints in your home. I mean, when we started, there were no products with amps and speakers built in. We didn't make an all-in-one. We had these little endpoints that had radio chipsets, would speak to each other and your router and communicate wirelessly over a network. So that was the key to it, the magic sauce. And then we added speakers and amplifiers to go from there. That's an incredibly important point, which I'll probably come back to. And industry leaders, I'm glad you guys are on board. You probably sold quite a bit of Yamaha and quite a bit of Heos, I don't know where to point, and other wireless products. And there are a bunch of really good reasons why some of our competitors are doing well, all power to them. There's also a really good reason why a bunch of our competitors have come over the last, in my experience, 12 years and gone. I was at Meijer in Chadston setting up a new point of sale many, many years ago. And as I pulled down our little display, which was like a third of what you've got there, and I moved it over to this big thing, the Pioneer rep was there and he took my old space and he put his wireless multi-room in. And about a year and a half later, it was gone and Pioneer got out of that. Samsung got into it, they got out of it. LG got into it, they got out of it. There are a great many brands that have introduced product, but because they're not a software-driven audio company, they have had to exit the market. The industry leader part of this, we're about 60% of the home wireless audio market. So with respect to all of the competitors and everything they do, if you guys are not selling Sonos, you're probably not selling an awful lot of audio, wireless audio in the home. And I say that with respect. Hopefully it comes true and you're happy with us. So these 5 points are the pieces that I want you to try and remember. And if you take nothing else away from this presentation, it would be these key points. So, amazing sound anywhere, premium design, easy experience, freedom of choice, and gets better over time. I'll explain what each of these means in the following 5 slides, and hopefully they will be apparent to you. So, it starts with sound, right? We're a music company. That first experience I had with the owner of Playback Systems, who were the importer distributor of Sonos at the time, putting that controller in my hand and saying, find some music, it was amazing sound and it was access to music that I wanted to hear immediately. Hi.
There you go.
Good. Feel free to yell out if you have a question. I remember an ad that my old boss at Carlton Audio ran once really annoyed the speaker manufacturer who was also part-time working there. He ran an ad. We used to do an ad in the Green Guide when that was a thing. Every Thursday, and he said, these speakers sound boring. That was the headline. He's a very colorful guy. And then he went on to explain in the ad underneath, they were EPOS speakers, and they are boring. They're incredibly flat. They're incredibly precise. There's no embellishments. They're not exaggerated in the bottom end. They're not exaggerated in the top end. I was thinking about that the other day. Our product in that same complementary sense is boring. There's not a massive top end, massive bottom end. It's not exaggerated. We're not Muteki. We're not party speakers. If you put a Play 5 or a 5, I've got to get the new terminology, right in a location in your home and then you true play it, I'll get to that later in the presentation, you're going to hear very, very clean, very neutral audio, really well presented. So it starts with high quality sound and that carries through from our basic Roam. I'm having trouble seeing where it is. There it is, laying on its back. All the way through to a pair of fives and a sub, which you can bring together as a kick-ass stereo system. Premium design. I mentioned in the first presentation, you won't see things like clocks, you know, digital LED displays, dancing lights. You're not going to see bells and whistles on our product that are superfluous to need. What you're going to see are very, very quiet, discrete products that blend into the home environment, right? It's a part of it is about not having things that are unnecessary. Part of it is about just not going out of style. So these are very clean, very easy to look at. Personally, I have one of these in white at home. It sits on a white benchtop in front of a frame TV, which is now getting a little old. Doesn't do Atmos. But the whole thing is just disappears. Keeps the wife happy, so. They're also made responsibly. Our packaging is made so that it's all cardboard. You would have unpacked some very recently. All of the internals, there's no foam, there's no foam rubber, there's none of that nasty stuff that's just going to sit in the environment forever. Pardon me. So, easy experience. One of the things we don't talk about, one of the things I didn't mention previously, even the unpacking experience is easy because everything is designed to be simple. I once had a guy who, early days when we would just put our product into JB, I communicated with him after he'd bought a system, and he was one of these guys, it's self-explanatory. He said, "I ran a stopwatch when I got your product. So from the time I bent over, pressed stopwatch, from the time I bent over and unpacked Sonos to powering it up, to running the free app, to getting music playing was about 2.5 minutes. Useful. I've used it in every presentation ever since. It literally takes 2.5 minutes to get music playing from a customer unpacking our gear, powering up, running the app, and pressing play. That's a powerful experience for most people who probably have a degree of, if you're mum and dad and 2.4 kids, a degree of wariness when it comes to audio technology or technology generally. The ease of experience from unpacking to setting up, to accessing music, to searching for some artist that you like, pressing play, and then sending that music to any room in the house, it's all of a like. It's all very, very simple. It's all very intuitive. The control is something that appears on anyone's tablet or phone who downloads our free app. So if everyone in this room got onto this network that Sonos is now on, downloaded our free app, you could all control each component individually or together. You could play a song from your phone or from a wireless, from a music service rather, into any device, and each of you could be in control of your own device. And in a household, a regular household, you have lounge room, and then you have my son, Zen's room, Kira's bedroom, master bedroom. You can name them anything you want. That ease of control, easy experience boils right down to the fact that you can have a room individually named, so you always know what you're controlling. And if I look at my son's room, I can see the volume level. If I turn it down, I can see him turning it back up again. Everybody's in control of the whole household. It's super easy. Freedom of choice, a really important one these days, because what we're seeing is a lot of technology companies who build what they describe as walled gardens, a fancy way of saying technology, one style of technology that doesn't play well with another. Sonos has always been really egalitarian when it comes to this. So when we introduced Google Voice Assistant onto our product, I think either simultaneously or shortly thereafter, we enabled Alexa voice control. You can have those two things running simultaneously in your household, and now you can have Sonos voice control running at the same time as well. They each have their features and benefits, their points of difference. I personally use the Sonos voice control because for me, I don't want to interrogate a smart speaker for news and weather. I use my phone for that. But I want to interact with my Sonos product to say, hey Sonos, turn the volume up, turn the volume down, track forward, track back, pause, whatever. Super simple. Likewise, that sort of come one, come all mentality extends to music services. I think we have something like 80 music services now available worldwide on Sonos. And they range, there's just two or three there. They range from, you know, Audible audiobooks through to podcast services, through to specialized Indian and African music services. There's a Chinese music service, it's just Chinese music. There's a French music service, Deezer, which I use, 43 million songs, really good for searching for jazz and classical because it's easy, you know, it has great search results. If I put B, it's more likely to come back with Beethoven than Beyonce. That's just one of those little things. You can have multiple Spotify accounts on a single household, and you can have multiple streams from a Spotify account, a single account, going to different rooms, up to 6, which is unique to Sonos. So it really is about bring whatever you like to our system, make it work. It's simple. It's come one, come all, as I say. Feel free to interrupt with questions. Gets better over time, a really key point. In that one of the first slides, it said that we're a software-based company. There are many, many examples of being a software-based company and our products getting better over time. This graphic, by the way, has nothing to do with that message. I cobbled this together earlier. Getting better over time means that a 9 year old play bar, which we don't sell anymore, it's the predecessor to this product, had DTS functionality introduced to it about 3-4 months ago, right? A product that's been in your house for literally 6 years. You do a free software update. Okay, Sonos has an update. You press OK. Your products take about 2-3 minutes to update, download, restart, and you've got new functionality. Another example, which is prime, is the efficiency that we were able to impose on the Sonos Move. When the Sonos Move came out, and I'm going to get these numbers wrong, I feel bad because I'm being filmed, there was something like 8 or 9 hours of battery life available once you took it off that ring charger. We were able to change the way the internal components worked and increase their efficiency, so now that's more like 10 hours. And we push that software update and we tell people, okay, by the way, now you've got 10 hours battery life out of your Move. There are other examples which include TruePlay, and I'll get to, which is monumental. Suffice to say that the products improve over time. They don't have built-in obsolescence. They don't go quiet after 6 years. I mentioned the Play Bar before and its additional DTS functionality. That was, for the 6 years it was on sale, the highest selling soundbar in the world because it was on the market for 6 years. The best selling and the highest volume in terms of dollars. What we don't do is we don't churn our products every 12 to 18 months. We're not going to introduce new products every 12 to 18 months. The lifespan, the average lifespan of a product in the past has been 6 years, which for a consumer electronics company is kind of unheard of. And we can do that, he said, harping on, because we're a software-based company. So those are the key 5 points, the differentiating points of our product and the reason why we are successful. We'll get into the product portfolio. The key thing to take away from this, really gratefully, is that we don't have a ton of products. We don't have 5 kinds of everything, 10 kinds of everything. Most of the time, it's 1, 2, or 3 products. That's it, good, better, best. If we bring a product in, normally speaking, we'll take a product out. And that's for it has to be for a very good reason. So we'll get into the all-in-ones. You've got them set up here. Again, I normally like to do a demo so you're not listening to me bang on for 30 minutes, 40 minutes. But our all-in-ones, I'll run through them fairly quickly. You've got the One SL, right? Perfect for a small room, bedroom, bathroom, kitchen, whatever. Great sound out of a tiny package and underneath that $300 retail price point. This does not have microphones built in, so it doesn't support voice control. It still can be TruePlayed, but that's because you're using the microphone on your phone. I'll come back to that later. I say all of that because I want to let you know the differences here. $319 for the One gets you the microphones built in and the ability to do voice control. So the virtues of that is you might have a One SL in the bedroom as just a music speaker on your bedside table, but for kitchens and bathrooms and any wet areas, last thing you want to be doing is touching the top of the speaker or your phone when you have raw chicken on your hands or whatever it might be. With this product, you can literally just say, hey, Sonos, or hey, Google, or hey, Alexa, turn the volume down 20%, turn the volume up all the way, skip a track, pause, whatever, and it will do it immediately. So perfect for places you don't want to actually interact with the technology physically via a tablet or a phone, etc. Pause for questions. All good. And the big daddy, the Five. I would encourage you to listen to this product in isolation. You've got a hard drive connected, I believe, to the network. So you do have, I saw many, many dozens of albums and probably hundreds, if not thousands of songs to choose from via this Android tablet. I would encourage you to add a music service. If it's your own, you can remove it if you want to afterwards. If it's the store's and you're happy paying for it, you can do that. And then you've got access to up to 43, 45 million tracks to demonstrate. Do so with the Five. It's an extraordinary product on its own. It can be used in isolation and give you an incredibly broad sound. It can be used with another one of its kind, and you can create a stereo pair, the virtues of which are through the roof. So stereo imaging, both in horizontal mode, and because they're a smart speaker, if you flip them vertically, you end up with a completely different soundstage. We have an accelerometer built into these products, as we do in the Move and the Roam and the Sub, if I'm not mistaken. So it knows what its physical orientation in space is. And I've done this demo countless times where, for a retailer we no longer have, sorry about that, we would start with a pair of Fives at the front of the room, and everybody, someone in the back left-hand corner, would hear stereo. They would hear the voice in the middle, and they'd get an incredibly, it's just a generous stereo soundstage. We did this as my colleague and I as a pair. While the music was playing, you flip them vertically and they know that they've been turned and they completely rejig their output. So you can imagine if this tweeter and this tweeter are firing as they are 90 degrees away from each other, the moment you put them into vertical mode, one of them is now firing downwards. That is attenuated to almost zero, so we pull back the audio on that. We turn down the one that's firing upwards and we accentuate or increase the volume of the one firing forwards. The virtue of that is if you're sitting at home alone and you have a pair of fives here in stereo, you then have a perfect stereo image right in the middle. It's very selfish. Everyone on the left and right would go, oh, and they'd lose that stereo image in a big demo. Suffice to say, it's incredibly flexible and versatile. So if you want great stereo sound, you can get a traditional stereo sound out of these vertically. If you want an incredibly generous broad stereo image and you move around the house while you're listening to music, just pop them into horizontal mode. I'm in danger of speaking too much about these products, this one in particular, because it has some additional functionality. It has the line input on the back, which, you know, a lot of products have line inputs. It's not sort of revolutionary. But because of the way we design our network and the overall system, anything you plug into one Sonos device is available wirelessly on every and all other Sonos devices, right? So conceivably, you could have a turntable plugged into this if it has a phono stage built in. And then you could have this quiet, the five, and you could be listening to that turntable through an amp and a pair of outdoor speakers in the barbecue al fresco area. You could be literally having a shower upstairs in the bathroom and be listening to an album that's playing on vinyl downstairs in the lounge room. You could even have the turntable plugged in here, but this is playing Spotify, and upstairs is the turntable that's playing. Anything plugged into one Sonos device is available on every and all other Sonos devices wirelessly, and it doesn't have to be playing on that original device. I know my throat's going to let me down. Pardon me. And portables, which are relatively new, particularly the Roam. This device, as I say, very new. It's our second foray into the addition of Bluetooth. So all of our products are Wi-Fi, primarily, right? They sit on a client's home Wi-Fi network, and that means that everybody's got control and everything I said earlier is enabled. If you want to use this product in Bluetooth, you can. It's simply a question of pressing the button on the back and it switches from Wi-Fi to Bluetooth, and then you can create a one-to-one relationship between your phone and it. Perfect for throwing into a suitcase or a picnic bag and taking outside, barbecue, whatever. I do take this with me when I travel. The initial, the initial product we brought out that was Bluetooth was the Move. It's deliberately designed to be massive, to be very, very powerful in sound, and have tons and tons of battery life, more designed to stay at home. The other point of difference between this product and something that may not be immediately apparent to you is that it has the additional functionality of Bluetooth line in. And what that means is that someone comes over to your home and you don't want them potentially on your Wi-Fi network, but they've got a ton of music that they want to play and you want to listen to. You can Bluetooth into this product, go into our app, and then join that with all of the rest of your products, and they'll all play in lock sync with what's playing here across the Wi-Fi network, which is a little bit counterintuitive and a hell of a lot of fun to do. So it kind of gets past that whole idea of, I don't want to let everybody onto my Wi-Fi network, but I want to share some music with people as well. This thing is submersible. It goes down to, I think, 3 meters. It's literally completely waterproof, so. I remember when they came out, we did the launch, there was drop tests, so it wasn't me doing the presenting, but carpeted floor, but quite literally just balance them on the finger and throw them into the air. Everyone's sort of freaking out. They bounce a handful of times, pick them up, they keep playing. It's rugged. It's exactly what you'd expect out of a portable speaker these days, including battery life. I mentioned this earlier, a huge sound. It actually sounds a little bit bigger than the One and the One SL, and as a consequence of that, it has a big battery in the bottom. The reason why that's developed the way it is, very deliberately, is it's a bit like a cat. If you lift it up, turn it upside down and drop it, it will turn over in midair and land on that rubber base. Just in case you do drop it, we want them to last a very, very, very long time. At $699, it's not a cheap, you know, Bluetooth speaker. It's really deliberately designed to always, in your home, sit on this charging dock so that it's always ready to use. So I have one of these, two of these, one in my upstairs area, one in my garage. And quite literally, anytime you want to take it outside, it's always at 100% battery life. I say all of that because one of the sticking points that folks have with Bluetooth speakers is they often sit in a cupboard or drawer or a bookshelf, and the moment you want to actually use them, you pick them up and they're at 5% battery life because they haven't been charged. These are designed deliberately to live in your home, be part of that Wi-Fi network, play just like a 1 or a 5, but that moment you want to take it with you, they're ready to go. Home theatre products. Compact portfolio that just got slightly larger. So our entry level used to be Beam Gen 2. The third or fourth slide here is the new Ray, just to give that away. The number one reason that folks come in and want a soundbar is because they're not hearing dialogue clearly. And Beam at a $699 price point gives you extraordinary dialogue clarity. It gives you great sound and it decodes Atmos and gives you the illusion of height channels and spatial audio through what is, as you can see over there, an incredibly discreet and small form factor. With the Beam and the Arc at $1,499, nearly $1,500, we have this as our flagship, and it does the upwards firing Atmos component. It has speakers built into it that are left and right firing, forwards firing, upwards firing. It decodes Dolby Atmos or Dolby Digital 5.1 and stereo, etc., etc., on the fly, and sounds extraordinary. With the Beam, and I say this in terms of business rather than speeds and feeds, the Arc and the Beam were reaching around 30-40% of the available market. So I'm going to skip past this next slide and come back to it. So we introduce Ray. Ray's at a lower price point and allows us to access that additional, up to 60% of the market, which is folks who want better sound. They want to hear the dialogue when they're watching something, even if it's at night. They want to be able to hear that dialogue clearly, and they want better sound than their TV. The old cliche is that the flatter and thinner that TV's got, the flatter and thinner their sound got, right? So crystal clear dialogue out of Ray, new price point, which I think, yes, is there. Thank you. I do lose track of them. Right there. In black and white. Perfect solution, and because it's a smart system and a software-based company, you can add a pair of ears, you can add a sub if you want to go absolutely crazy. You could start with this in your main room and just have it on its own, and then you could add a sub, then you could add a pair of ears, then you could take that, take away the sub and ears or leave them in the room, take this up to your master bedroom, use that for your master bedroom TV, and replace it with this for the main room. And just do that through our software. An entirely modular, flexible system that's easy to change. I'll go back because one of my favorite products and the hinge, if you like, that a lot of our home theater systems sit on, sub. A massive sound, nearly $1,100. The sub, being a wireless product and part of the family, can be added to a 1 or a pair of 1SLs or a single 1SL or a 5 or a pair of 5s. It can be added to a Beam or a Ray or an Arc, and it can be moved if you wanted to into different systems. If you had a party and you've got a pair of outdoor speakers and an amp, you could take this outdoors, set it up with the amp, and it will operate in concert with those. Otherwise, it could be, like it is in my house, full-time with the Arc as part of the home theater TV music system. Not only does the sub very obviously add tons of bass, it's very cleverly designed to give you massive amounts of bass without vibrations or additional noises, it takes away the onus of mids and highs, it takes away the onus of the bass rather having to come out of here, and allows this product, whatever it's added to just do what it's good at. So if you have a product like a One, which has a bass driver that's about that big and a tweeter, normally speaking it's doing everything in the audio spectrum, or it's trying to, as well as it can. You add a sub to that, the sub takes over from 20 hertz up to about, 50, 60 hertz. And then the mid-range and the high frequencies of whatever it's connected to just pop out and get 100% better. And you can demonstrate that for yourselves as well. Skip forward past that. So, I'm going to assume that you're all more or less familiar with Atmos, what it does, why customers are looking for it. That spatial sound, that illusion of height and depth in the audio, both Beam and specifically Arc designed to actually give you that, quite extraordinary. I'm having fun with it at home, but I do have to update my TV, as I said. Let me just go back a slide. There you go. So I was talking before about TruePlay and the idea that a software-based company can improve its products over time. If you design, develop, manufacture and release a speaker. You have control over every step of that process, right? There's control over it. You don't know where a customer puts it. We demonstrated this technology really simply and actually perfectly. We had this penthouse in a hotel. We invited all the dealers in and we said, okay, we're doing a free software update in about a month and it's going to introduce TruePlay. I hate that. It keeps going. It's hypnotic. So what we did is we took a one, and the only electricity outlet in the room, it was a kitchen in this penthouse suite, was behind a coffee machine, because you had the bench top, no electricity, you had the wet area, the sink, no electricity, and then you had the stove top, no electricity, and then you had just the corner on the left where there was a big ass coffee machine. And that's where the power was. So what we did is we took a one, we plugged into the power, it was right there, but we left it behind the coffee machine and TruePlayed it. When I say we TruePlayed it, that means I took an iOS device, a phone, I selected the product, I selected TruePlay, it tells me to turn my phone around so the mic is pointing up, and I literally just sweep the room whilst the speaker made a weird noise. It does a sine sweep and a white noise background. It listens to all of that and it listens to the effect. We know what the speaker does when flat, and we know what this microphone, plural, microphone's characteristics are. We hear the difference between the two things, the two knowns, and we adjust for the unknown, which is the room. We send that curve, we send that data up to the cloud, and then we send back a curve that is the equal and opposite to the effect that we've heard on our speaker, and it brings it back to factory neutral. So we did that demo over and over that day. Speaker behind a coffee machine, it essentially sounds like that. And people would hear that difference, and then you turn TruePlay on and it would sound like that. You can do the demo for yourself, or later on I can do it here as well. TruePlay effectively means that our speakers sound great no matter where you put them. So if you've got to stick it behind a monitor, it's going to sit at your feet underneath a desk because there's no more desk space. Regardless of where you put our products, if you TruePlay them, they're going to pop out into the room and sound as good as they possibly can. That was a free update we did. And it equalizes all of our products for the space that they're in. I should just say, before I get into that because of the nature of our two portable Bluetooth Wi-Fi products, the Roam and the Move, they auto TruePlay. So they have that same accelerometer that I mentioned in the 5. And about 7 seconds after you set them down, they will adjust their EQ to the environment that they find themselves in. They do that when they're listening to the music that they're creating. So again, to exaggerate that, the way we demonstrated it is we took a Move, and we had it playing music, whatever song you choose. I would do this now if it was set up. You stick it on a sofa with a cushion over the top of it, literally lay it on its back and just put the cushion on top. And of course it sounds completely muffled. You can't hear any of the high frequencies. And about as long as it takes me to finish this sentence, it would re-EQ its output entirely and people would just go, okay, I get it. It's a powerful demonstration to do, and it just means that regardless of where you take the speaker, it's going to sound great. I mentioned before flat, thin, and the primary driver of soundbars. Two little widgets that we have that are unique to our Ray, Beam, and Arc soundbars are speech enhancement, this little bubble here, and night mode. So speech enhancement does a phase correction. It does a little trick with timing. And what that means is if you're having trouble understanding or hearing the dialogue in relation to whatever else is going on the TV, you hit this little thing here and it just says speech enhancement is on, and the audio associated with the dialogue pops into the room several meters. It's quite a fun thing to play around with, and it basically expands that soundstage and brings the voice into the room, makes it a hell of a lot clearer. You can use that in isolation, or you can use it in conjunction with night mode. And night mode is that. You hit that little widget there on the bottom, and essentially what it does and what it is a compressor. It just compresses the loudest parts of the audio channel, whatever's coming out, the program, and it takes the lowest parts and it brings them up. It operates on our volume slider between 0 and about 40-45%, any more than that, and we know that you're listening loud, so it doesn't make an effect. I've said the what. The why. You're at home, you're in bed, you know, you're done for the night, you want to watch, as I did last night, the last episode of Ozark, or what I believe to be the last episode, but the kids are in bed, two rooms away. So put night mode on. If someone gets shot, that gunshot is within the middle of the audio range. And if people are whispering and talking like this, and there's something going in the background, it brings their dialogue up. So it's a perfect little feature to use when you're listening and you don't want to disturb other people. You can use them, as I said, in isolation, of course, but if you use night mode in isolation with speech enhancement, you get the best of both worlds. Audio pops out, you can hear exactly what's going on, but you don't get any nasty surprises when the helicopter blows up. Interesting. I've used the words flexible and modular a couple of times with our system. You can have one SL, you can have two ones, you can have two fives or one five. You can put them together as a stereo pair. You can add a sub to them. You can start off with a beam, an arc, or a ray now, and you can add a sub to it. You can add two subs to it. You could add a pair of rears to it. They could be ones, they could be one SLs, they could be fives. Conceivably, if you wanted to go to the trouble and you had electricity readily available, you could have an arc and a sub operating in your main TV lounge room, and you could have a one in your bedroom and a one in your bathroom. On movie night, you could bring those down and associate them through our app with the arc and the sub, and there'd be rears for a home theater system. When movie night's finished, you just disassociate them with the system through our app, you take them upstairs, put them back in the bathroom and bedroom, and then you go on music speakers. They'll do anything you want them to do. Again, they're a software based platform, so very, very flexible. And that brings us to the last part of the portfolio, which is architectural, which is actually where we started. I mentioned before when I was first demoed this system, it was essentially what is now this product and the port as well. They've changed names and we've updated them significantly since that time. The architectural range consists primarily of the amp, which is 155 watt by 2 digital amplifier with all of the same functionality as all of our all-in-ones, so any music service operated off your phone, into a pair of passive speakers, bookshelf, floor stander, into a pair of outdoor speakers, into an outdoor set of speakers, whatever you like. So this product brings the functionality of Sonos, you can see the price point there, into any third-party product that you want to connect it to. I don't know if you ever get into these conversations. Looking at what you do, I expect you do. 155 by 2 is into 8 ohms. It's stable into whatever speaker you put it into at 4 ohms. It's stable for 2 pairs of speakers if they're both 8 ohm, and that drops the load to the amp to 4. And uniquely, because we know the physical electrical characteristics of these products, it's stable down to 2 ohms and can operate at high volume levels through 3 pairs of these or 3 pairs of the in-walls. Now, normally speaking, you wouldn't recommend that to a customer because Murphy's Law is, I want 3 in-ceiling speaker pairs and I want 1 amp. That customer is coming back to you and they're saying, but I want to listen to different music or different volumes in those 3 different areas. You need 2 amps to do that. But if it's an outdoor area, say I can imagine a really nice, beautiful house, the length of this building, and you've got 3 pairs of outdoor speakers, that amp will work on those 3 pairs of speakers all day, every day, and deliver that 155 watts into them cleanly and without overheating. So a really flexible product. Awful lot of integrators use these and they stack them up in racks and then the cabling goes out to the rest of the house. Super simple setup. If you have your own amplifier, be it a 2-channel analog device, a valve amp, an AVR receiver amplifier, or even a pair of active speakers, that's what this does. This provides you with that radio connection, the wireless connection across the household. It provides you with the source parts that I mentioned before, like Spotify, Apple Music, Audible, podcasts, Sonos Radio, on and on and on. All the music on earth, effectively, cabled, wired into your existing amplifier or pair of active speakers. At $699. And then, our collaboration with Sonance. So Sonance are a huge player in the in-ceiling, in-wall architectural speaker market. We worked with them. These are effectively their second from, that's a tight squeeze, the second from the top of the range architectural products. You'll notice the price point, it's at the upper end of what they do. The key differentiation, the reason why you want to sell these products is that TruePlay functionality. So if you partner these, a pair of these, or 2 pairs of these with that amplifier over there, you run the TruePlay, it sends a signal from the amplifier to the speakers and allows you to do that TruePlay tuning. The problem with in-ceiling and in-wall speakers is that they have literally no idea where you're putting them. So I've put in-ceiling speakers. Look up, there's no ceiling. I put in-ceiling speakers into a space like that. It could have the full meter and a half behind it, or it could be padded behind it. It could have insulation. It could have bleed through to other rooms. It could. You have no idea where it's going in that space. You could sell somebody a pair of $10,000 in-ceiling speakers and they could sound worse than a pair of $300 in-ceiling speakers in a different environment, right? So the environment has a huge impact. Using these two products together allows you to true play them. The same product, but in a different form factor and exactly the same functionality, so true playable in wall for the front. You see a lot of these next to big screen TVs where somebody doesn't want a soundbar, very discreet system. Outdoor speakers, you have a pair of them up there. Again, in operation concert with the amplifier that we put out, huge sound for an outdoor area. Just to be clear, you can't true play these because in an outdoor area, we assume there's little to no boundary. So there's no reflected sound and really there's no way to account for the outdoor acoustics. So the key points that I want to, you guys to take away as per sound quality. And I would encourage you whenever you talk to someone about Sonos, this is hypocritical. Don't do what I'm doing. Don't talk to them about it for more than about 30 seconds without asking them what they want to hear and pressing play and just getting them involved in listening to music, choosing music and actively listening. The premium design thing for me speaks for itself. People are either going to love it or they're not, but I think we've got a very clean look and a very easy to live with design. That easy experience, 2.5 minutes from unpack to music playing, and in the case that I'm talking about, free music access with Sonos Radio. The freedom of choice for customers to listen to whatever music service they want, to use whatever voice service they want, or not use a voice service. Products with mics, products without mics, functionality that's super easy and hopefully easy to explain, and gets better over time. There's no redundancy. I mentioned before, the Playbar was on the market for over 6 years. It's still on the market in terms of being used and supported. It's in thousands of households worldwide. And if we have software updates that introduce new functionality, it gets better over time. We don't have churn. I mentioned before, this product was released only a year and a half ago, 2 years ago. It will be on the market for another 3, 4, 5 years easily. And that is it. You've been very quiet. And I'm happy to throw it open to questions so I don't have to listen to the sound of my own voice. There were questions that came up, there were questions that came up in the previous about network and about commercial application and about the maximum amount of speakers in a single network, a single home network, and that's 32, by the way. That includes a pair of rears, that's two products. It includes a sub, that's an additional product. But you can have 32 pieces in a home network. More if you chuck a ton of money at it, but needn't get into that for the purposes of this presentation. The whole system assumes one very basic thing, and that is the customer has a router with a Wi-Fi network, very common these days, ubiquitous in fact, and that the internet comes into that same product. If a customer says they don't have a router, don't sell them Sonos. Sell them a router, then sell them Sonos. If they're saying they're using a 3G stick, 4G stick, 5G stick, and they've just got this little Telstra doohickey, don't do it. They don't assign more than 2 or 3 or 4 IP addresses and you're sunk. Customer has a router, which is again, almost a given these days. They have a Wi-Fi network. We operate on all of our products at 2.4 gig. If you create, and that includes the arc, the beam, and the ray, the moment you add a pair of rears and or a sub to a home theater soundbar, it kicks up to 5 gig and operates as a little private network on 5 gig. So you get great communication very, very fast. But essentially all of that happens in the background and it happens entirely invisibly. There are two ways to set up Sonos. I'm preempting questions. You can connect one of our devices to that router via an Ethernet cable. And we then have our own mesh network that again is invisible. And basically means that each Sonos component, so I believe your router is over there somewhere. If you had a Sonos component hardwired to that, that first piece would speak to this wirelessly, but this piece would actually speak to that piece wirelessly, and that one would speak to that one. So the moral of that story is that you could have a one over on that third pallet over there, and then you could have a one in the car park, and then another one in the restaurant up the road. You could keep going up to 32 components, each one with about 20 meters between them, and each one will be speaking wirelessly. You could have 300-400 meters away a single product playing music, and the product over there that's wired to that playing music, and they would be playing in lock sync, perfectly synchronized. And every one of them between could be either playing music, different or same, or not at all. So it's powerful. The gentleman that was here before said he's got a double brick, very large house, and he was basically saying, it's not going to work in my house. I said, tell me after you try. There are very few domestic scenarios where a cabled connection to a single Sonos device doesn't allow us to communicate across a vast area wirelessly. I will pause for questions.
That actually was my question.
See, I talk too much. Yeah. The other part of that, of course, is, you know, what if? What if it doesn't do what you expected to do? You sell somebody the dream, wireless audio, going to be easy. They take it home and it doesn't work. They can call you and you have rights and obligations that you need to fulfill. But if you want to, and if the customer is up for it, you can ask them to contact the Sonos tech support team. And we have something like 35 people who work full-time to do that. Easily 80%+ of the issues that we encounter daily are upstream of Sonos. It's the router, it's the network, it's the Wi-Fi, whatever. We'll fix that for the customer and we'll take that problem away. So support, customer says, I've got a dinged product, it's got a bend, easy, give them a new one, we'll give you a new one. But if it's a network issue, you can't see it, you can't diagnose it, you can't fix it, we can. We will literally remote in with their permission. We'll fix their network, we'll change the channel of something that's interfering with us, or we'll change our own channel from 1 to 6 to 11, whatever it might be. And we'll back out of that securely, leave the customer with a fully functioning system on the first call. We don't charge for that, and it's a valuable service that you should be taking advantage of. It allows you to get on with selling.
And that service runs 24 hours, or is it on set times?
It's headed towards 24 hours with a cut over to Europe and US services. That hasn't happened yet. So at the moment it's, I always get this wrong. I think it's 10 till 6, Monday through Friday. And it's, as I say, local.
Melbourne time?
Yeah. Don't mention that to our brothers in Perth. They get a bit grumpy. But Perth and Auckland. But that's it from me, and I just, you know, thank you for being so polite and listening so intently. If you have, no, thank you. And if you have questions or comments, I'm just going to pack up slowly and then you can ask me individually if you so choose.